Hello everyone, I'm Beeman, and here's another Conan Exiles tutorial. You might be already familiar with this house, as it was featured in my small role-playing homes video, and I've been asked a few times how I've built it. So, here it is. The base for this home is a simple 8x6 rectangle. The tricky part is finding the right terrain, as it is crucial to get enough of a height difference to create the basement workshop. Usually I prefer to build homes in sheltered areas, so that they feel safe and secure, but this one would stand out anyway, because of the height and color, so instead of trying to hide it, I've decided to actually do the opposite. I've chosen this spot on the little cliff overlooking Islet Lake in the far north, where the house will tower over the flat area below, while the snowy terrain and trees provide a beautiful backdrop for all the red elements dominating the structure. This is also consistent with the story that is told by the house. Home is never just a location. It is an important character building element, so I always start the design process by inventing a character, and then fitting the location to the person. In the end, the story is never told, but only implied by the various items around the house, the overall design, feel, and symbolism of the place. This actually sounds way more complicated than it really is. It will work even if the story is simple and characters forgettable. What matters is that there's a general idea, a consistent theme that guides the design. In any creative activity, whether it's writing, painting, or something else, the most terrifying thing is the white empty page, still waiting for the first word, brush stroke or note. Then there's the problem of all the ideas that come to mind, as they often focus on a single aspect of, sometimes, quite complex object. For example, you might imagine a perfect cottage in the woods, smoke rising from the chimney, trees gently swaying in the breeze, but then you start building it and find out that you've no idea how to divide the internal space into functional rooms. Our imaginations like to take snapshots. Realizing the idea means designing everything that's behind the camera. Of course, most of the time our daydreaming focuses not on places or objects, but ourselves. And that's the key to good design. Think of a person, not the place. The private space, a home, is a reflection of the character. Consider Batman for a moment. Bruce Wayne is a billionaire socialite, living in a luxurious mansion, yet inside it is empty and nostalgic, reflecting the feelings of loss that permeate all aspects of Bruce's life. The facade is a lie, both for the house and character. Then there's the dark damp cave underneath where his alter ego dwells. Anger born of pain, loneliness hidden by luxury. In a similar fashion, Superman tries to live a normal life as Clark Kent in Metropolis, but the lonely alien Kal-El, the last son of Krypton who will never really fit, lives in his fortress of solitude, far away in the Arctic. Basically, instead of trying to figure out what to do with all the space inside your dreamed of house, create a character, or even choose a simple archetype, like warrior, rogue, etc., and go from there. As far as the gameplay requirements are considered, this is not a fully functional base. Things like map room, wheel of pain, or shrine are simply too big for a small house. There's enough room for the basic crafting stations though, so it's somewhat playable, and the missing stuff can be easily added outside. The house has four levels. The basement's shape is determined by the terrain, and it has no internal divisions. The ground and first floors have two rooms connected by a hallway in the middle, which also contains the staircase, while the top floor is wholly taken by the master bedroom and its two balconies. The outer shape is extremely simple. It's just two stacked boxes, the top one slightly smaller and with added gables. The thing that makes this building look cool is the roof. I've encircled the whole house with roof tiles on every other level. The lowest one is made with awnings, the rest with regular roof tiles. On the middle level, right above the entrance, I've placed two internal roof corners to create enough space for the Dragonhead trophy. After placing the doors, I've added lamps on the corners of the ground and top level roofs. The middle level has no external lights, as they simply wouldn't make much sense there. Finally, I've placed the red dragon head above the door and moved on inside. When I first started playing this game, I was obsessed with finding extremely flat places for my bases. Now I actually do the opposite. Uneven terrain makes a lot of cool designs possible. Here I've used it to create a small basement with all the basic crafting stations. The combination of workbenches, storage and low ceiling gives this place a rugged industrial look that contrasts with the remaining parts of the house, which is great. Rooms should have an atmosphere that's consistent with their decorations and purpose. If you've seen the original video, you might remember that it started by showing the owners of all the houses. This is "And They Lived Happily Ever After" part of the story for those two adventurers. They found the treasure, killed the dragon, and now live in peace and quiet of their own home. The whole building reflects that. Obviously there's a dragon's head nailed above the door, and a small armory tucked in the corner of the master's bedroom, but most hints the owner's past are a bit more subtle. For starters, all that treasure would definitely allow them to get nice furniture. So for this one I've only used high quality, decorated furniture and metal dinnerware. To enhance the feeling of luxury and comfort, I've placed light sources all around the house, either fireplaces or kitchen lamps, in an effort to create a significant contrast between the cold, harsh weather outside and the warm, comfortable, welcoming interior. Room layout follows the principles of vertical hierarchy and privacy spectrum. This simply means that the further the room is from the entrance, the more restricted it is, and the more important the person, the higher his private space is located. In this case, this means that there's dining slash reception room and kitchen on the ground floor, two bedrooms for either children or guests on the next, and master bedroom on top. Light is a very powerful tool, even though its influence is often very subtle. In this case, the red walls feel completely different depending on the light shining on them. Inside, the lamps bring out the warmth of both the red and brown parts of the wall. This is opposed to the external look. Against the backdrop of snowy landscape and bathed in cold light, the house doesn't feel so welcoming anymore. It stands tall and proud, like the warriors who live in it, defying the wind and snow. Yet in cold light of a winter's day, the red and white also invoke images of innocence lost in violence, pure white snow marred by blood. Another subtle way to create a certain feel to a room is creating a centerpiece. Here I've placed some sloping walls next to the stairs to very softly divide the room. There's the central part in front of the stairs, and two alcoves on its sides. The general feel of the room will be decided by the composition of the central part that's immediately visible upon entering it. In this case, I've decided to put fireplace and two chairs there. This is consistent with the theme, as, at least for me, this arrangement immediately invokes the images of couples sitting there, enjoying life's simple comforts symbolized by the warmth of the fire. But on the other hand, one could also sit there lost in thought or memories, watching as the flame turns once living wood into ash. The armory, most obvious link to the adventures of the past, is tucked away in the corner, still well maintained, yet somehow insignificant. Now both interior and exterior are done, there is still one more extremely important step. The house simply looks artificial, fake, and doesn't fit the location. So it requires blending. In this case, I'm simply going to add trees back, a lot of them. This is relatively simple, the only thing that I pay attention to is leaving some more or less obvious paths leading to the house and placing tallest trees first, then surrounding them with the lower ones. And now it's finished. If you enjoyed this video, consider subscribing as there's more coming. Thank you for watching.